we know why we're here, so I'm going to make this short and sweet. And I'm going to bring out right now Randy Bachman and Peter Frampton.
Hello. We were talking backstage, and Peter said, is that applause for us? Are we supposed to be going out there?
Randy, you can put your guitar here if you want. Well, Hello. Welcome. And thank you all for getting up early and coming to our little interview service, as it were. So we did this last year where I combined a couple of different artists, and it worked so well. And these two gentlemen are friends, and they've worked together before, so I thought this would be kind of cool. First and foremost, Randy, this is your second cruise. You did Rock Legends 2. So how are your sea legs this time out?
Last night was, even today is kind of shaky.
A little shaky.
My sea legs are good, though. It kind of rocks you to sleep.
Peter, I was going to bring the Dramamine for you, but I did forget. I apologize.
Thank you.
Okay. Last night it was a little difficult for you up there. You you had Mother Nature at her best with the wind and then the rain.
Yes, it was a challenge. Because all of a sudden it was like, well, you're not on for half an hour. No, we've got to hold it. Then we had the rain, the wind, you're on in 5 minutes. That's it. So it was. We had to just find the window of opportunity and. Unfortunately, for the encore, it just started to pour, so sorry about that, anybody was there. Yes. But nothing I can do about it. It's just Mother Nature.
It happens. So, where did you two guys meet? When do you remember the first time?
Oh, gosh. Was it the 70s, were you there?
The early 70s. the early 70s, I was with Bachman Twin Overdrive. He was him, Peter Frampton. I had been a fan of his back from Camel and Humble Pie and all that stuff, so I knew exactly who he was. And we were kind of like struggling at the same time with the Doobie Brothers and ZZ Top and the Allman Brothers were all kind of touring down south. They thought he was Southern and BTO was Southern, and we were all playing these Southern rock kind of things. But it was a great audience to get going on KC in St. Louis. Remember those stations?
Yes, absolutely.
Like that. Yeah. They started to play our records, and then suddenly he's on the radio, and BTO's on the radio, and ZZ's on the radio, and the Doobies are on the radio, and we're still here today thanks to radio. And you guys.
Absolutely.
It does say a lot, stands the test of time. Speaking of which, so if you're driving along and one of your songs come on the radio, do you tune out or do you turn it up? Either one, Peter.
It depends what city you're in. You got to admit, it's amazing. You're in Australia or you're in England, and suddenly your song comes on. You're in an elevator or in a gym working out, and your song comes on. And everybody's working out to your song. Yeah. You know, like oh, baby, I love your way, and taking care of business. You know, that kind of thing. It is still a thrill that the stuff that we did as kids is still played on the radio and is the soundtrack to not only ours, but everybody else's life.
Yeah.
Well, if indeed you did meet in the early 70s, here we are 40-something years later, and you've been recently working together. Randy, you were a part of Peter's Guitar Circus Tour, and then Peter played on your last album, played on the song Heavy Blues, so...
Yeah, it's fantastic. It was a great thrill to finally get to play together, you know, so even though in these days you send people files... And then it's not like you actually all meet up in the studio these days. It's much easier to get people to play on your records because you just email them a file, and then they. So it was a great thrill that he asked me, and definitely a lot of fun to do.
But it's kind of like Christmas, opening a present. Like I get a file from Peter Frampton, and my producer Kevin Shirley, who's a really great producer, said, well, I got all this stuff from, and I just got a note from Peter saying, I overplayed on this song. Just pick and choose. And I heard what Kevin Shirley picked and choose, and I said, just put the whole thing in there. So if you get that song, Heavy Blues, Peter is just playing his face off. It's just, and his heart out. It's just amazing playing. And it's almost like we're live in the room because I don't stop singing and then he plays. We overlap and step on each other's toes, which is what live rock and roll is about. It's guys mashing together guitars and vocals and everything. And it's pretty incredible.
Well, so how does that exactly work, though? You know, did you hear Peter doing the solo in that song, or did you just say, I would like to have him on the album, let's see if he'll do something for this song? How did that work, and what was the direction you gave him?
The direction I gave him, and I had a couple other soloists on there, Neil Young and Joe Bonamassa and guys like that, is...
No pressure.
I want you in this song. I don't want to tell you what to play. I know how you play. I've seen him play for decades. I've gone as a fan and sat in the audience to see him play and stuff, besides being sharing a show. And see how he plays blues and rock and roll, and every once in a while does a Django Reinhardt thing that just like blows your mind if you're a guitar player, because you throw in this little extra little bit of sauce that you don't normally get. And I just wanted him to be himself, and he was, and we left every note in that he played. It's just amazing. It's pretty much a Peter Frampton guitar solo with me singing in between little breaks.
You're very kind. Thank you.
And your approach to it then when you heard the track?
Well, it's always a challenge. Like he said, you open up the little present of the track that he sent me. And it was just, first of all, a thrill that he asked me. And then you just, for me, I just like let it soak in at home through the headphones or through my home stereo or whatever. And then I go to the studio and put it up and just get a sound that I really feel fits with the track first, which is not only fitting for the track, but it's inspiring to me because I can't play if I have a bad sound. It just does, it's not inspiring at all. So, and then, you know, the track spoke to me and said, play here. And it was just a thrill, you know. I always love when my heroes send me tracks and want me to play on them. So, thank you.
And for me, it's a guitar lesson.
No.
Listening to his licks, because normally I'd play in a certain position on a guitar in a certain part, and he's playing somewhere else, and you got to figure out where he's playing and how does this wonderful run of notes come out of nowhere on this fret. You know what I mean? That kind of thing. So it's been a great thing for me.
And let's talk about the Guitar Circus. You know, you had quite an array of guitarists join you for that tour. Rick Nielsen, Buddy Guy, I believe, was on, B.B. King. You asked Randy.
Yes. Well, it was, I had my wish list, and most of the people I asked were able to come because of timing. And it was a thrill. It was a... Definitely for our band, usually we have a sound check and then we do the show, or if we can't, we don't have a sound check. But this time we had to get together every day in my room and work out today's artist. So when Randy came a couple of times, first time he came, we all got together and played the stuff. And then he would come for the sound check. And then we would... just play the song through a couple of times, literally just a couple of times, and then do it live. It was fantastic. Each day was a different person, so it was fantastic.
And, you know, in doing my homework here, preparing to talk to you two today, who I've, you know, I've, full disclosure here, I've interviewed them many times, and they're both wonderful and always accommodating. You both came through the ranks later in life, as it were, but both Ringo Starr All-Stars.
That's right, yeah.
Randy, I believe Randy was in 2, and Peter first came in 3, or was it 3 and 4? But talk about that, you know, because, yeah, Randy was in the 3rd one, and Peter was in the 4th All-Star band.
I don't like talking about that.
Oh, I'm not going to ask you for any Ringo dirt.
All right, okay. What do you want to know?
But I was just curious what it was like, because you two have always led your own band. So here it was, you know, being a band member for someone else. What was that experience
like? Well, for me, I mean, I just wanted to be the guitar player in the band, just like my first guitar hero, which was Hank Marvin of the Shadows. And so I always wanted there to be somebody else to take care of the singing. I didn't want to do that. You know, I'll do some oohs and ahs, but that's about it. So then when I left Humble Pie, I got my legs a little bit singing-wise and had the best teacher in the world, Steve Marriott. And I would never approach ever his talent, but as a vocalist. But I did learn a lot from him. And then I think the first time that someone asked me to go on the road with them was Bowie, and my dear friend, and we went to school together, and so I've known him all my life, and so. Yeah, and so it's obviously it's very, very sad that we've lost him, and I'll miss him dearly, as we all will. But playing with David was a dream come true, because he was always a mentor to me. I was, I think, 11, and he was 14 when we were at school together, and so he was already in that band that I wanted to be in, you know, and then gradually... I left school early, actually. I dropped out at 16 and started to play in The Herd, which was, I think, 50 years ago now. So, so that was a huge, huge thrill. And then a few years later, I'd already played with Ringo on a few of his records, and he'd played on my very first solo record, Wind of Change. And so he asked, Pete, would you play on my tour, you know? So it's hard to say no to a Beatle, right? Very, very hard. And there was supposed to be another guitar player on the tour that I did. There's supposed to be two, but it ended up just being me, which was sort of a dream come true, because I had Jack Bruce as the bass player, you know, which, I mean, luckily he liked me. We have heard stories, but
God rest actually,
I have to say this. I'm sorry, I'm talking too much, but I have to say this, that I was at an event, a charity event, and Eric sat right opposite me, and I was with another dear friend of mine. I'm dropping bombs. Bill Wyman took me. You know, I've known him since I was 14. So anyway, I'd already said hello to Jack, who was over the other side of the room. And so I said, Eric, Jack's here. He went, really? You know, he scares me.
And Randy, for you being part of Ringo's All-Star Band.
Well, it's like Peter said, you don't say no to a Beatle. The night before... which was, I remember it very clearly, it was a Wednesday night, it was PBS, and they had on Help and Hard Day's Night, and Help and Hard Day's Night, and Yellow Submarine over and over and over, as a fundraising thing on PBS. And the next morning, my phone rings, and it's from Monaco, and it's a voice, I can't do the accent, hello, this is Ringo Starr, would you play in my band? And I hung up the phone. I thought it was my road manager joking. And then the phone rings again, and it's him and my wife saying, this is Ringo Starr. And I said no at first, and then I forget, am I insane? And so it was really a great band. And when that was over, I went to see the next band, I think the first gig of Seattle, and I saw Peter with him, and I saw him play Sunshiny Love with Jack Bruce. And I said, damn, Peter, I want to be up there on stage. I wanted to play that solo in Sunshiny Love, that do-do-do-do-do, that kind of thing. And Jack Bruce, he paced the stage like a lion in a cage. Yeah, when he was singing Sunshine, he would just walk around the stage. This guy is a maniac. I wanted to play with this guy so badly. But
he made you play better. You know.
Oh, yeah, Jack, yeah, just, he did. And being with Ringo was quite an experience. It was like they said on the front end when I was negotiating a fee, they said, when it's all over, you know, David Fishaw, you would have said you would have done it for nothing, and I would say that now I would have done it for nothing. The fun of being with Mark Farner and John Entwistle and Billy Preston and Zach and Ringo was absolutely amazing. It was the stories we told each other that you will never hear. This can't be put in print. About ex-managers, ex-labels, ex-bandmates, ex-wives. Unbelievably great rock and roll stories.
That's right. That was Entwistle on that tour, so you didn't have such a shabby bass player either.
No, just to play Boris the Spider every night was, like, fabulous.
Did he play nice and quiet?
Well, we were all told to... Does that say... We were all told to bring a 50-watt amp, me and Mark Farner. John Entwistle showed up with a 3,000-watt amp. Two bass speakers that were the size of refrigerators. And he wore very tight pants, but with big bell bottoms. And he was pretty deficit of hearing. He would stand in front of one of these bass bottoms, and you can actually see his pants flapping from the disbursement of air from the bass speakers. And we'd be playing a theater sometimes this size, and he would turn up full blast. I don't like active guitars, which means it's an active pickup with a battery that boosts it louder. John Entwistle not only had active bass, he had four active pickups, one for each string, yeah. with four 9-volt batteries. And so when he would play the bass, he would just touch it like this, and it would be the loudest solo like you ever heard, like from my generation. And after the tour was over, I'd go into the dressing room. Mark Farner would be laying on the floor of the dressing room, holding his ears, like writhing on the floor. And maybe I shouldn't say this. We were gonna sue John Entwistle
for his ear damage
and Ringo, because we both had tinnitus for basically 2 years after that, which is this ringing in your ear. This it's there all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
That's right. And have you noticed though that John, dear friend,
wonderful guy,
lovely guy, but have you noticed that he talks like this, but he plays really loud, so.
Well, he reads lips, and he thinks everybody else can read lips.
So, John, what do you think? Sorry, John, what was that? Sorry.
Very true. Learned a couple of things on this cruise. You know, I've come seen both of you play, and I've got my little notepad and taken some notes, and... I learned from, from Grand Funk the other day that they actually asked you to join their band in the early 70s, 73, 74. Do you recall that? I mean, what...
I do recall that. There are very few things I do recall from that period, but I do recall them asking me to join. Yeah, it was an honor that they asked. I mean, we as Humble Pie, had played... with them. In fact, we, Humble Pie, were the first band on the stage at Shea Stadium after the Beatles left. Because we supported Grand Funk on that big show that they did there. Right. So, yeah, we've been friends for a long, long time. So it was a thrill. But it was something that I'd already... I can't even remember whether it was as I was leaving Humble Pie or before I'd left, or I guess it was after I left.
Yeah, I think it was as you were going into the Frampton album.
See, I don't remember a lot. But, it was something. I'd already left a band to be able to be in control of my own destiny, as it were, and being a control freak, you know. So I wanted to do my own songs and lead my own band at that point.
Well, it worked out for you, so, you know.
But you know what? I did get to play with them. They did the...
the Bosnia benefit. That's
thank
right.
You.
You did, yeah.
The Bosnia benefit, that's right. Yeah. And they asked me... I was actually rehearsing with Ringo at the time in L.A. and had to come all the way over just for the day, and it was a lot of fun.
Right, that's right. And Randy, a lesson learned in your show the other night, Stevie Ray Vaughan... wanted to do Taking Care of Business.
Yeah, I got a call from a guy named Charles Comer, C-O-M-E-R. It was kind of Stevie Ray Vaughan's, not official manager, but his PR guy, and got songs for him and stuff. He lived in a hotel in New York City, I remember that, this guy. And he said, Stevie Ray Vaughan wants to record Taking Care of Business. Would you write a third verse? Because, you know, classic rock, you repeat the first verse again, then everybody thinks they know your song. The first time they hear it, because the first verse is the same as the third. And so I wrote a third verse and sent it to him. And then within that month, the terrible crash happened. We lost Stevie Ray Vaughan. So some nights I sit down in a chair and play a slow shuffle version of Taking Care of Business and sing that third verse that I wrote for Stevie Ray Vaughan.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's really great.
All right, well, let's see. We've David Bowie, Jack Bruce, John Entwistle, Stevie Ray Vaughan. Okay, enough. Let's, may they all rest in peace.
Yeah.
And now, watch this segue. Something was brought back to life in 2011. So I went back and I dug out some notes here because I wanted to make sure I had this right. In 2011, Peter, I'm going to toss this over to you because they want to hear it from you, not from me. I remember many years ago, during an interview with Peter, we got, I think it was around one of the tributes to Les Paul while Les was still alive, and Peter was involved, I think, on one of the albums, if I'm not mistaken.
Yep.
And so we're talking about the Les Paul guitar, and the conversation turned to this here. This, sorry, I'm going to take this. This guitar, no, not yet, sir. This black Les Paul. And and Peter told me, it's gone. It went down in a cargo plane crash. I was going to do some dates, I think, in South America, Central America. It's gone. 2011 comes, and I'm going to pass it over to you. Was it a phone call? Was it an email?
No, it was contact Peter on my my website, and I do see those, so you can email me there, frampton.com, and just says contact Peter. And So Lisa, my manager, sends me the ones from the website, and I open the email, and there are 12 or 13 forensically taken shots of this guitar now, which was 30 years later at the time. And of course, I thought in 1980, when the cargo plane crashed in Caracas, that it was gone back to the earth, because it was a fiery crash on the runway. And unfortunately, to put it in perspective, people lost their lives on that plane. So the guitar, as much as I was starting to miss it, it put it in the right perspective that, hey, people went in that too. So I got over it and just got on with everything. Very hard to play any other guitar because this was the only guitar apart from 1955 Red Strat that I had that I played on Show Me the Way. And there I see these shots, and I know that this is my guitar. The guy says, is this yours? I said, no, that's not mine, because I knew he was going to charge me $1.5 million to get it back. So anyway, there's a gray area for a couple of years there, which I can't go into, and it's far too detailed story. But nobody wanted to bring it back to me because they thought the FBI were going to meet them at Miami Airport as a stolen, because it was stolen from the debris by the guard, the guy that was guarding the debris. he thought these, apparently three or four guitars did make it. They were broke off in the tail section. And so he thought they'd be much safer at home. And then a couple of friends of his thought they would be much safer at their home if they gave him some money. So that's how it goes. So anyway, to cut to the chase, I'm in Nashville. I got a hotel room there, a suite. I got three cameras running, and this guy, we fly him up from Curacao, which is an island off the coast of Venezuela. And he comes in with the Minister of Tourism from Curacao, and they want to make a meal of this, obviously. And so there it is in this horrible plastic case he's got. And he just hands it to me. And because it's such a light Les Paul for being a solid one, he said, Peter, feel the weight. You know it's yours before you even see it, right? Feel it. So I said, yeah, it's very light. So I opened it up, and there it was, and it was a yelling moment. So, and then we just took from there, from that hotel room, I just said, yes, it's mine. And we took it straight, all of us just got in cars and went to Gibson in Nashville and got it verified that it is what it is. And it's a 1954 Black Beauty that was customized by Mark Mariana, who is the guy that gave me the guitar when I was playing with Humble Pie in 1970. So we just did a reissue, a clone of this, a 35 of them, and guess who got the first number one? Mark Mariana, who gave me that guitar.
That was
so
sweet. Very nice.
So that's the story, and now it's back and I'm playing it.
So the so the guitar was, as Peter said, a Gibson, and in 2012 he goes on tour, and in February of that year he plays the Beacon Theater in New York. So I made sure to go to that show because there was word that this was going to be the show where it was going to appear, and sure enough, it practically walked out on stage by itself. I remember there's a lone spotlight shined down on it. So this is New York, and you know, obviously Peter's got a lot of friends there, but and he had to get going right after the show. But he agreed that he would email me answers to some questions as to how it played and everything. So I emailed him, and he sent me an email back. I said, he says, "It plays great, but we are still getting to know each other again. It's her sweet tone that I have missed so much. This is a dream I never bothered to dream. How did this happen? Amazing. We have a lot of catching up to do. I am way beyond being thankful." And just so you know, these were not private emails. Peter knows that I provide music news to radio stations. So
I didn't know that.
Oh, you didn't know that? Oh. The hell you think I want to talk to you all the time for? I really don't like you otherwise. But anyway. So
he'll never talk to me again now, that's it.
No, I will, because you always record your answers when it's on the phone and send me
I
a
know,
file,
I
so
know.
I feel honored. But anyway, so here we are. This was 2012. Here we are 6 years later, just about, 4 years later. Yeah, 4 years later. How is it playing? Are you back in love?
Yes, we are. Yes, absolutely. It's after they did, I told Gibson that I just wanted them to bring it back to be able to play. I didn't want any of the scars to be removed at all. So, you know, it's pretty scary. And at the end, the top here, the headstock, that's where the fire was right there. So it melted all this stuff off. And luckily, I think the air in the case used up, so it stopped. But it stopped burning around here. And all we did was change, the electronics was not working, and so I just went and found time-sensitive pickups Patton applied for us. Now it's Tom Holmes pickups in here. But all the electronics are, you know, from the 60s or late 50s in there, even the toggle switch. So we tried to keep it, you know, as time-sensitive as possible. And it plays like an MF, I tell you.
Wonderful story. And no strangers to Les Pauls or guitar collecting. You've got an exhibit of your guitars. We'll get to that in a minute. But what can you tell us about this beauty sitting right here, Mr. Bachman?
This is a replica of my 59 Les Paul. The real one's in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. It's the American Woman guitar. Yeah. I was playing a gig with the Guess Who, and this is like 1967, in Nanaimo, B.C., which is a little island. And it was a place like this, but much smaller. It was the basement of a church. And so in the basement of a church, it doesn't have a high ceiling. The stage was only about 6 inches high. It was a little platform. So I'm standing on the platform, and I'm playing a Mosrite at the time, a Joe Mafus Mosrite guitar that's very hard to play. Mine's in being fixed, and the clearance is probably an inch at the 12th fret, so it's very hard to play on this Mosrite. And a young kid walks in the back door with a brown case. So if you're a musician, you know what this little brown case is, or a tweed case, you know it's an early Fender. The brown case, you know it's some sort of Gibson Les Paul. And he opens the case in the front of the stage. I'm up there singing with the Guess Who. And he points like this to the guitar and to me, and I look at the band and I go, what the heck? I get to play this Les Paul. So in the middle of the song, I take off the Mosrite, I hand it to the guy, he hands me the Les Paul. I tune it up. It's amazing to try to tune these, because with the Bigsby on, the minute you tighten one string, the spring goes, and they all go out of tune. It takes me a whole song to tune it up. And I play the whole night on it. And when it's all done, I go to the guy and I say, thanks very much. I always wanted to play one of these. And I hand it back to him. And he says, you mean you don't want it? I said, what do you mean? He said, I don't want this guitar. I wanted a Mozrite, like the Ventures were playing. And I want to trade you. And I said, this is not a fair trade. I'll give you all the money I have in my pocket, which was $72. And the most right for this guitar. And then the serial number was 9-0319. I knew it was a 59. So that guitar went on to be the sound, the beautiful dark woman tone of American Woman in No Time, and my stuff in the Guess Who, and then later when I played it in BTO. But it was so heavy. It was like 14 and a half pounds.
Oh, my God.
It would really wreck my back. So it basically looks new. I'd only play it sitting down in the studio. And then for a stage, I got a Stratocaster and put humbucker on it, so I kind of had the Gibson sound. But because when I went to a back doctor, he said, stop playing guitar. And I said, ha-ha. And he said, well, then go get the lightest guitar you could possibly get. And at the time, it was a Fender Strat, which were like 7.5 pounds. So that's the guitar.
Yeah.
You two lucky son of a bitches. You got people come and give you guitars at concerts. Yeah. How cool is this? You know, as I mentioned, all these... real quick... So, not only are you a player of Les Paul, Fender, that you mentioned, but you had quite the Gretsch collection.
Did he ever?
I did.
And it's on
my
exhibit.
First guitar was a Harmony Silvertone. I still have the kind of like Jimmy Page plays, that little black thing. Had one of those. It was like $49 from the Sears catalog. And then I grew up in Winnipeg with a great guitar player named Lenny Bro, who played a lot of Chet Atkins stuff. And then Duane Eddy played the same guitar in Eddie Cochran, so I always wanted a big orange Gretsch. So I got a big orange Gretsch G brand with the Yarmouth pickups, and it was really a great twangy guitar. I played that on Shakin' All Over and on Taking Care of Business, same guitar. And then it was stolen from a studio, and I thought I would never get it again. I have never got it again. I think the guy in the Thompson Twins has it. I've seen it in the video, Doctor, Doctor. Anyways, that's a different story. But this is before there was any internet. I used to get a monthly, he probably did. I'd get a monthly thing from Gruen Guitars or Norman's Rare Guitars, a little monthly newsletter saying what was for sale, and I'd phone them. And they'd all call me saying, well, we got a Gretsch this, we got a Gretsch that. Nobody wants Gretches. They're not a big deal guitar. They're poorly made. You know what I mean? That kind of thing. And everybody's buying and selling Fenders. And we got this guitar in a trade-in. We'll sell it to you for, you know, $150. So I started buying Gretches, with hopes of finding mine back. We didn't get an orange one, but we found a white one. We found a silver sparkle. I ended up with a dozen, then two dozen, and then I think it's called the midlife crisis hit in. And so rather than a blonde and a red Corvette, I just, everywhere I went, I'd seek out Gretsch guitars. And I remember one day I had got a call from Duke Kramer, who was running Gretsch at the time, and Fred Gretsch had got the name Gretsch back. He owned Gretsch drums, but not Gretsch guitars, because it had been bought by somebody else. Called me back and said, I got the Gretsch guitar name, now we can start making Gretches again. How many do you have? And I said, about 350. And he said, I've got to come and see them. So he brought a guy from Minneapolis named Pete from Pete's Rare Guitars and Duke Kramer, and they came to my house. And I had 8 kids. So every time one of the kids would leave and go to college or get married, I'd go, wow, another bedroom. And I'd hang these guitars, on the wall, 3-3-3-3-3. So they came and saw the guitars, and they asked if they could borrow my collection, 2 or 3 at a time, to measure them and caliper them and calibrate them and make the new Gretsch guitars, because he had the name Gretsch, but the factory had burnt down. They lost all the templates and everything. So I let him do that, and then after a while, he called me and he said, there's a Fender Museum, there's a Martin Museum, and you own my museum. Will you sell it to me? So we did a deal, and I sold him the 385 Gretsches, and I think there's maybe 100 that just are on display now in Nashville, the Country Music Hall of Fame. They just opened it this last week. I'm here, or else I'd be there in Nashville, where they have the Randy Bachman collection. And Duane Eddy was there, and Steve Warner there playing the guitars. But they're some of the coolest Gretches you'll ever find, because they go from 1928. Wow. The old Robert Johnson-looking arch tops with a big hole in the middle and things like that, up to all the prototypes. Because my deal is, I'll let you copy mine, but I want prototype 1 and prototype 2 so I can check it and see. And sometimes the switch would be in the wrong place, and I tell them to correct it so it looked like the original. So that was a really big deal for me, collecting those guitars. And then when I sold it, I was able to buy a flat in Covent Garden.
Oh, okay. Yeah, you know, Eric Clapton donated, auctioned off all those guitars to raise money for his Crossroads Center. And so one time I asked him, I go, well, how's it feel not being able to go back to, he goes, I bought them all back. Not the ones that he sold, but he went back and he actually went out and bought a whole another collection. So he goes, they've all been replaced. Some are even better than the originals. So
I did get new ones. Part of my deal with Fred Gretsch is he wanted every Gretsch I had. So I said, then I won't have any Gretsches. So I need a white one, an orange one. So give me five more as part of my purchase price. So I got them and I played them. And they are made better now than they used to be. Because before they were made by hillbillies. Like in Arkansas, like I would get Gretsches that were made in the same week, the same model. Because, you know, I had two dozen orange ones, two dozen white ones, three white falcons, things like three white penguins, two dozen white falcons, things like that. And they would all be different. And in checking into it, I found out these guys got paid per piece, per guitar. So they would sit around Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday morning playing poker and whatever. And then Friday when they're going to get paid, let's slap together 10 guitars because they're each getting $5 a guitar. So if they ran out of certain tuners on a Gretsch, they would put on more expensive tuners. So you can buy the cheapest Gretsch and they would have the knobs that had the pearl and the ruby in them from a white falcon. Or they'd have Grover Stair Step Imperial tuners that are beautiful tuners. And so they were all kind of different like that. And the necks were kind of wobbly and everything. Now the new Gretsch is made either in the custom shop or made in overseas in Japan are amazing, fantastic, very solid guitars, very dependable.
Peter, do you have the Minister of Curacao's phone number? Maybe he's got that orange Gretsch that he's looking for.
No, I don't, unfortunately, no.
I wanted to, again, you know, these commonalities between these two guys. Your offspring, and I don't mean the band, but you've got children who are following in your footsteps. Peter, Julian is here on the cruise, and he's got up and played with you and been doing that for a while, opening your acoustic tour.
Right.
And, of course, your son, Tal Bachman. So, Peter, starting with you, what's it like? Do you let him find his own way? Has he come to you for a lot of advice?
Yes, he comes to me with a lot of advice. But the great thing about anybody who becomes a musician is that you can learn from a novice and you can learn from someone who's been playing for 50 years. And I've learned stuff from, everybody plays differently, everybody has a different style. And he's a phenomenal, inventive guitar player, and also an incredible songwriter lyricist as well, better lyricist than me. And so, you know, when he, when we first got together and he had a song and we recorded it, that was when he was pretty young. And then all of a sudden, he started on drums, that's right. He wanted a drum kit. And we were on the All-Star Tour. And so I managed to get a starter kit from him. And he came to see the show and came backstage. And Ringo's sitting on the kit. And so Ringo got up and said, here's your drum kit. You know, so that we've got pictures of that. So here, but anyway, then I, because I'd given him a guitar when he was way too young to even play it, and then all of a sudden one day, he said, "Dad, listen to this," and he picked up a guitar and started. I went, "Oh my God, wow, that's great, man!" So, cutting to much later, when I was doing an album, Mr. Churchill album, thank you, Mr. Churchill, and we decided to sit down and jam. You know, and we came up with two or three different songs and settled on one. And Road to the Sun is the song that we did. And he sang the complete lead vocal. I sing one line on that, which I forgot the other night. and it was the track that radio actually picked up. You know, hopefully you get one track that these days that at least classic rock will play, one new one and an old one. And that was the track they picked up on. So it was almost the lead track from the album. So, and now he's playing with his writing buddy and playing out, wants to get a band together. And he could act if he wants to. And he's very funny too. So
I love my son. He's great.
Wonderful. And Randy, for you, your son, Tal, he had some success as well and is out there working. Did he come to you for advice, or did you let him find his own way?
Very similar to Peter's son. Tal started playing drums. There's a picture of him 2 years of age at a BTO rehearsal, sitting there playing drums in a little baby thing with a, we call him a pepka, a soother. The Ukrainian word is pepka, means nipple. Around his neck, you know, he'd put it in his mouth and play drums, and he's sucking this little soother. And then he went on to play guitar, and I remember saying to him, do you want me to teach you anything on guitar? And he said, no, I don't want to play like you. And he was buying Joe Pass and Django Reinhardt and Eddie Van Halen and learning all that stuff. And so he kind of learned on his own, and then he started writing songs. He had a really couple of really big hit records, and he's doing very well today. And I'm very proud of him. And all my kids, we all got together at Christmas. There was 22 of us. And had a whole week together, and every night getting out the acoustics and singing every old Eagles and Beatles and Stones and Frampton songs and all these kind of things. And it's amazing how the young kids, my even grandkids who are 8 and 9 and 10, playing ukuleles, play Oh Baby, I Love Your Way, you know, like Peter Frampton. It's like, it's a great ukulele song.
That's some questions. Some of the passengers submitted some questions, and this one comes from Louise Fields, and she asks, and it's addressed to both of you, so feel free, whoever wants to chime in first. Do you get more satisfaction out of your music and creative process now as opposed to back in your heyday?
That's a good one. You want to go first?
No.
All right.
I think we maybe would agree. The creative process doesn't change. It doesn't matter if you're 14 or 40 or late 60s. You write a song, you have this dream, it's a great song, you play it for the band, you play it for your wife or your mother or somebody, and if they go, that's a great song, did you write it? Because you really don't know where they come from, and you don't get sued by anyone. Yeah, I've written the song, you claim ownership to that song. And to get it in the studio with a band, and it gets jammed out, and then it gets on the radio, and if they pick that one track from the album and start to play it, it's like, whew, I've done it again. It's like our childhood dream to, I grew up with the same thing in Neil Young in Winnipeg, wanting to play like Hank Marvin in the Shadows, just like Peter did. The clean, amazing sound they had on guitar and the rhythm guitar of Bruce Welch and stuff like that was just amazing. And we wanted to copy those guys. And then Elvis and then the Beatles, you always want to copy the latest, greatest thing. But when you actually look back, like we can look back now, decades, 3, 4 decades, 5 decades, and go, wow, we're still doing our teenage thing, and everybody likes it. In the old days, you'd hope that you went into town, and they're playing one of your songs, because you're playing a show that night. Now we go, and they're playing 8 or 10 of our songs on classic rock radio, and it's kind of a dream and very surrealistic, really. Surrealistic, not surrealistic. It's both. You can take over from that.
For me, I think when I first started writing songs, I don't think I knew what I was doing. I know I didn't know what I was doing. I was just trying to write songs that I would like. And that's been my MO ever since, basically, that it has to be something that pleases me before I can hope to please anybody else. And I think that... I try to, as you go, I didn't know, like some of my songs don't even have a chorus, the early ones. You know, the theme is like, okay, there's an intro, there's a verse, there's a bridge, a B part of the verse, then a chorus, and then, you know, the same thing over and solo, and then there's a format to it. But I didn't have a format. I didn't know there was a format, and I think that's what I try to forget all the time when I'm writing, so I don't follow any format whatsoever. I know too much now, that's the thing. So it's like I'm still trying to write like I don't know what I'm doing, because I think that's when the most inspiring things happen. And also, the more simple things are, it's very difficult to play things more simply now for me. And I think those are the things that are... definitely catch people's ear. So it has changed, but I'm still working on the MO that I had when I started, or trying not to think about what it should be next. Well, there should be a chorus here or whatever. It's difficult because you learn so much along the way about writing songs, and it's every time I sit down, I just try and throw that all away and just write from my stomach, you know.
That's interesting because on your last album, Kevin Shirley pushed you out of your comfort zone in your approach to playing and crafting songs.
Yeah, he did. Very much like Peter, along the way you learn too much. And you'll find that the guys we like are the guys who are playing at their peak and never got any better because they already were the best. And I'm talking like Chuck Berry or Bo Diddley or B.B. King. They just got to that point and they played that the rest of their lives. They didn't learn any scales or the Mixolydian scales that some of these guys, but I don't know any scales. When you just play from the heart and what you think fits in the song, like these guys who were basically inventing guitar rock and roll, like Chuck Berry and Hank Marvin and guys like that, they got a tone and they just played very simple. And there's something about that. And it's the same thing with like playing guitar and writing songs. You can get so overly complicated. I showed up with some songs for my heavy blues album that had 16 wonderful chords in it that, you know, that would baffle a jazz guy. And Kevin Shirley would come and say, "This isn't blues. Like, can you take away 14 chords and give me two chords?" And I go, "Well, then I have to change the melody line." "Yes, that's good." "And we'll have to change some lyrics." "That's good." And then we would come up with a song on the second or third take, and you go, "That's the one, that's energy." Because you can put so much more energy into playing "Hey Bo Diddley" than you can into playing "Giant Steps." At least I can. You know what I mean? Like, one is like a zillion chords, and you're always thinking. The other one, you just relax, you fall into that groove, and you do your turn, chicka, 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 and you get into that, and it's hypnotic, and then it's easy to, the whole audience gets that vibe. So I think LCD, which is lowest common denominator, is really important. That's why we're here, I think. Nobody buys our greatest licks.
Right.
I like yours, you like mine, but they buy the real simple talk box kind of thing that they all can kind of do with their mouth. And, you know, I remember I was on tour with Eddie Van Halen and a couple other really great guitar players, and I'd be warming up in the dressing room and doing all my Chet Atkins and Lenny Bruce harmonics that I normally do. And they'd stick their head in and say, "Gee, that's really cool. Never play it on stage. No one will ever like that. Like, go out there and just play your normal stuff, you know."
Even they like the hits, I guess, huh? Well, could be worse. You could never have had a hit, and you're both very blessed in that regard. A couple upcoming things for the both of you. Peter, you've got a new album coming out, Acoustic Classics. You've been doing a tour which you call Raw, breaking it all down acoustically, you, Gordon Kennedy. You also have a new song on this album called All Down to Me. Just talk about that whole experience, and you will be doing some more acoustic tour dates, raw tour dates, I think in March, west of the Mississippi, if my memory is correct. What's that whole experience been like for you to, you know, actually go back to the germ of that song, break it all back down?
The idea of going out and playing an acoustic tour, just me, basically, in an acoustic, was scary, you know. Always wanted to have the band there with me. And people have been asking me to do that for a long time, and I just said, no, I can't do that. So I decided that I would do an acoustic album of, I'll do my older songs and one new one, but I'll do my older songs just with one acoustic and maybe and voice and maybe an acoustic solo that I would overdub, but that would be it, no more tricks. And so I thought, I went into the studio, I have a little studio in Nashville, and I whipped off three that afternoon. I thought, wow, this is great. Then I went to listen to them, and I thought, where's the band? They sound like it's me, and we've recorded it with the band, but the faders for the band are down. Because I've been doing those songs with the band for so long that I just been doing my part, you know? And so I said, I think this is going to take longer than I thought. So it was the feeling that I wanted was, when I'd just written the song, And I said to Randy, hey, sit down. I just want to play this song. I just wrote this one. And I sat down and said, lines on my face. And I played that. And I would, at that time, perform it so differently from the way I do today with the band live. And so I would then every day come into the studio and I would do a take of lines and I'd do a take of Baby I Love Your Way and all the other ones. And then I go, nope. And then tomorrow I come back and then I go back and listen to all of them. And it was the moment of that inspiration of playing it just like I'd just written that I was looking for. And eventually I found it, you know, gone back to, again, the simplicity of how you wrote it. And so something that I thought was going to take me a week has taken 4 months. So, you know, it takes a lot longer to get, but each day I would do a full performance of all the songs, you know, as many as I could do in a day, and then finally chose the ones that I felt would make you come in like this when you were listening to them, rather than, you know. So I hope I've achieved that. I don't. For me, I think I have, but that's for you guys to see when you get a copy of it as you leave this room, which is locked until you do. I one of those.
And Randy, you had Heavy Blues last year. You went out as a trio with two females. Will you be working with them again? I noticed you have the band on this cruise. Will you be doing stuff in the trio format, or was that part of it done? And
well, out of the blue, I got offered a record deal by True North Records, which is a really great Canadian label. And they said, we want you to reinvent yourself. Peter and I were in Nashville. We got inducted into the Musicians Hall of Fame a couple of years ago in January. And Neil Young was there because his pedal steel player, Ben Keith, had been inducted as well. And I went to Neil and he said, you know, he always says the same thing, what's shaking, man? And I said, well, I got offered a record deal. And he said, don't do the same old RB stuff, crap is what he said. You know, do something new, challenge yourself, get scared. Remember how scared we were when we were 14 and trying to play Man of Mystery by Hank Marvin, all these incredible things. Get that scared again and you'll feel it in your music. Get on the edge, do something fierce and fearless. And at the, I'd been invited to see Tommy. So I went to see Tommy in Stratford, Ontario, which is the Shakespeare Festival. But on the edge, they always have a modern thing. It was the new digital version of Tommy. And I found I was sitting behind Pete Townsend. And I'd known Pete for quite a while because we had arguments over the name The Who and the Guess Who, which, I won't get into. In fact, I said to him, do you remember 1967, the Marquee Club in London, when we came? And he said, you know, frankly, mate, I don't remember 66, 67, 68, or 69. Well, okay, that's the end of that. So anyways, he leans back to me and he says, the drummer sounds like Keith Moon. And I said, the drummer is a girl. He said, it can't be. We look at the program, it says Dale Brendan. I said, it's leaving out Anne. It's Dale Ann Brendan. I played with her before. She's amazing. So we go backstage after, and it was this female, Dale Ann Brendan. And then I go to the Juno Awards in Winnipeg where BTO is inducted into the Hall of Fame. And I go to see a country band that night called Ladies of the Canyon. And there's this beautiful tall girl playing bass who has a t-shirt on that says John Entwistle. So I meet her the next day for lunch. I said, you like John Entwistle? She said, yeah, I have a degree in stand-up bass from Montreal, from McGillan University, jazz bass, but I love John Entwistle. And so this thing goes on, click in my mind. Why don't I get the drummer who drums like Keith Moon and this chick who drums plays bass like John Entwistle, and do an album of what was, to me, the most influential thing that Peter was part of, the late 60s blues trio. And I call The Who a blues trio because basically it was three musicians, right, and the singer. Hendrix, Cream, Zeppelin, same kind of thing. It's the interplay of the three guys. So I get these three girls together, and Kevin Shirley, who says, simplify every song, take it down to a minimum of one chord, two chords, three chords, and scare yourself and do one or two takes. I don't want anything more than two or three takes. So we did everything in about two or three days, cut a whole album. And then the surprise was he sent me a track saying my next door neighbor played on a song. And it was Joe Bonamassa. Then I got invited to do Peter's guitar circus. I thought, well, I'll invite Peter. And then we played LA. Robert Randolph was on there. So I just threw out a thing to him. And God bless these guys. They all said, yeah, we'd love to do it. And like the magic of sending them an MP3 or something, they played it and sent it back. And I opened this gift from Frampton and Joe Bonamassa and Robert Randolph, and Neil Young. He was like in Israel at the time, sent me a track. And somehow it sounds like we're all in the same room. We are. It's the world. It's called the world, but it's like we're in the same studio. So it was a magical thing for me.
Did she show up with a 3,000-watt bass amp too?
No, she showed up with about 4 amps and a bunch of basses, like 12 basses. But I took the John Entwistle bass that Fred Turner used to play in BTO. It's the one single pickup 4,000 Rickenbacker bass that for some reason sounds amazing. You don't need to put any EQ on it. It just sits in the middle of the track, like an old Fender Precision bass. It just sits right there. So we AB'd about 12 basses in this one test song, and blindfolded her and Kevin Shirley always picked out this Ricky bass, which I just recently bought. And stupidly enough, at the end of the session, I'm sitting there next to Kevin Shirley, and I'm going, man, does she play great bass. It's just like Jack Bruce. It's just like, you know, Noel Redding. It's just incredible. I think I should give her that bass. Then I hear, oh, thank you. And I didn't realize she was sitting behind me, and I was stuck. I had to give her the bass. She's still playing it to this day.
Well, on last year's Rock Legends Cruise, I did a panel that included the Doobie Brothers, Don Felder, and Dave Mason. And Dave Mason said he's been after the Doobie Brothers manager for years to get them two to do a tour together. And so they're going out this summer together, Doobie Brothers, Journey, and Dave Mason. You know what? You guys need to go do a tour together because...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Peter.
I like that.
The Les Paul tour.
Peter tours the States religiously every summer. Randy, he comes down every so often. He'll pop in, you know, like in Ohio or Michigan and stuff like that. But he needs to be in more cities around the country. And thank God we get him in New York once in a while, too. But I think that'd be a tremendous tour. We only have the hour, so we're down to the last 3 minutes here. You got a few things coming up. Just a quick reminder, both are playing tonight on the pool deck. Gee, look at that. Peter at 8 o'clock, Randy at 10:15. Wow. Now, Randy, you should probably come down a little early to catch the end of Peter's set, don't you think?
Yeah.
And
I get Peter to hang around for my set.
And Peter, if you pack today, then you can stay late and watch Randy's show.
Yes.
All right, very good. All right. Got that out of the way. You know.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I guess here's a question I could throw out to both of you, and then we can wrap it up on this. To go back, you know, you guys have anything in the vaults? Because, you know, a lot of people these days do the box sets, things of that nature. Peter, anything for you that you'd love to get out there someday?
I think there's more stuff that I've been doing recently that I just want, because I now have my own little studio, so I go in there and I just play because and record stuff. So I do have stuff. There's very few things from the old days. Everything in those days for me was used, just about. I mean, we did reissue the live record with, there was a couple of extra tracks that were never on the original Frampton Comes Alive.
Right.
So we did bring those out. But no, it's mainly everything was used.
Yeah, Randy, you got so many incarnations, Guess Who, BTO, your solo work.
Well, there was a BTO box set a couple of years ago that I went through all the old tapes and put a couple of live tracks from Japan we recorded at the Budokan. And that kind of exhausted the BTO thing. However, I just got recently contacted by Sony RCA that there was an album I cut with the Guess Who that was supposed to follow the American Woman album, which was our big number one album and single, that album didn't really get finished or come out. And they played me the 9 or 10 songs as we just did them, the four guys jamming in the studio. And I was in tears. I didn't remember a lot of these songs. And they said, can you go back and remix this and put down an extra guitar, because I usually play rhythm guitar and then add a lead later, or play lead and add the rhythm later to fill it all out. And I'm looking at doing that. It was very exciting. I was literally in tears hearing
that
stuff.
That's wonderful. Well, unfortunately, that is the hour. We have to clear the room here. So, you know, I could go on and on. The great thing about both these guys is they...
You going to announce the winners of these guitars?
Oh, the stories. Who's getting them? Again, they're both performing tonight. They are both in the Musicians Hall of Fame. They need to be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Peter Frampton, Randy Bachman, thank you both so much.
Thank you all.
Thank you.